The only way to educate yourself in this world, in a world that's going to be more and more about freelancing, is to actually acquire the skill of skills acquisition, to learn how to think critically about the world and digital media environments that you're spending all this time in. So it's a much deeper kind of a learning. In some sense, you know, it's more liberal arts, not less.
Welcome to Education Futures. I'm Paul Zenke. I'm happy to be joined today by award-winning author, educator, and documentarian, Douglas Rushkoff. His new book, Present Shock, When Everything Happens Now, explores the always-on, simultaneous society in which we live, as well as how this new temporal landscape influences media, culture, economics, politics, and meaning. Thank you for joining me.
Hey, all right. How you doing?
So, Douglas, you have a new book out called Present Shock, When Everything Happens Now. What is Present Shock?
Most simply, Present Shock is the human response to living in a world where everything happens, you know, now. You know, it's kind of a real-time, always-on existence without a past or a future, without origins or goals, kind of just the present. And this presentism or present shock really affects us on, you know, on a personal level, on a social level, politically, economically, and even spiritually, you know, in terms of how we, you know, organize our experience of life. You know, my concern is that instead of really seizing the new now of the moment, we tend to get disoriented. You know, we respond to the insistent pings on each of our devices. You know, we kind of chase the moment that Twitter or Facebook or one of these devices offer, you know, and forgetting that we're the ones who are living in real time. And the devices, the software is what's chasing us. So it's really about how do we seize the true present that's being offered to us by a digital age, by our liberation from the industrial age clock, and how do we avoid the kind of the faux present of these sort of insistent pings of the digital universe.
What are the challenges and opportunities for formal education resulting from present shock?
Well, I mean, there's a bunch. I mean, one of them is, the one bias of the digital age is that it gives us more choice, right? So rather than following the prescribed paths of the masters of the various academic disciplines, someone can go online and get the course or the information and what they want when they want it. You know, you don't have to go through architecture 1, 2, and 3 to get to architecture 4. And while there's some tremendous liberation associated with that, there's also something you lose in that. What you lose is the path, right? You become very focused as a student on the data and getting that piece of information as if that's the thing that's valuable. And you lose the centuries of thought that went into how these things were arranged. You know, I was just thinking about, I was in a library, and I was thinking about the card catalog the other day. And, you know, I understand that the digital search lets you find the thing you want right away, and you get the number and you go and you get it. But what you lose when you lose the card catalog is not just an alphabetical listing of the books by title and by author. You're also losing the subject area. You know, you could go into a card catalog and find the area that you're in and then look through the cards that are in that section. You know, and they've been put there. They found their way there really over centuries of the organization of information by people. So it's not to say that it should cripple you, that now you have to engage with information the way that the greats have been doing it for centuries, but there's centuries of knowledge and insight that went into that. So as education becomes more a la carte, as kids get what they want when they want it, you know, as we use Spark Notes to do Shakespeare because we have authority over our time and I can decide not to really read it, but just to read this paragraph, I lose a sense of the journey. It becomes very results oriented, and that's a big, big challenge. The other biggie is, you know, as we spend more and more of our time kind of fetishizing these devices and these, you know, sort of new avenues for education, I feel like the human bonds of the classroom, the actual people who are in the same room together, that loses its cohesiveness. It loses its power. The big challenge for people today is, you know, doing very simple things like maintaining eye contact, generating rapport with other human beings, understanding how to work with others. That's the kind of stuff that you can get in a classroom and you can't get on a Wii, you know, when you're at home. And I'm really encouraging educators, you know, not to use classroom time to have kids all staring at the smart board or at their iPads, and instead to use that valuable few hours of class time you have helping kids and students orient to one another in real space. Because there's, you know, that 94% of communication that happens non-verbally is starting to get lost, you know, as our noses get further, you know, closer and closer into our smartphones.
In 2001, he hosted and co-produced the Frontline documentary, The Emergence of Cool. The film describes the techniques used by corporations like MTV to research and sell products to young adults. He closed the film by saying, "So is there anywhere the commercial machine won't go? Is it leaving any room for kids to create a culture of their own? And what if they turn and fight? The battle itself is sponsored, packaged, and sold right back to them." In 2013, what is the status of the Merchants of Cool and young adults' abilities to fight back?
Well, I guess the Merchants of Cool are here and bigger and better than ever. You know, instead of, you know, sort of watching kids, I mean, the Merchants of Cool at that time were sending out little sort of spies and scouts and kids with, you know, Polaroid cameras and video cameras to really try to record youth culture and then kind of feed it back to itself, you know, to put the things that they found into ads and onto TV shows, and then you kind of sell kids back to themselves. And there was this sort of feedback loop that was going on between the trend hunters, the cool hunters, and the kids. And now kids really, through social media, they deliver themselves directly to the marketer. You know, the marketer doesn't need to observe them. The kids are already posting everything up there. You know, so where, you know, in the old days, the quaint days of 2001, you know, the marketer would have to go into the kid's bedroom to see what posters he's put up on his wall and how, and photograph them. Now the kid's putting these things right up on the Facebook wall. You know, so they're broadcasting everything as their new form of cultural expression. And then you can see what works and what doesn't by how many likes that thing is getting. It's funny. I'm just starting on a update to that Merchants of Cool, and I'm calling Generation Like. And the idea is that, you know, kids are living in a world where their own self-expression now is what they like. It's all relative in the sense that they, you know, they are what they like, and what they like is matters to them really almost exclusively for the power it has to get them liked themselves, you know. So it's sort of moved into a hyper version of its former quaint self, and there's just as many millions of dollars going into it, but now it's more into the sort of the big data analysis of every keystroke that these kids make in order to kind of predict where they're going and what they're going to be doing next.
In chapter one of Present Shock, you discuss the collapse of narrative. And this chapter got me thinking about the idea of the American dream, that you work hard, you play by the rules, you go to college, and then this is really the gateway to the middle class in America. What does Present Shock have to say about our traditional notions of the American dream?
Well, you know, the American dream is kind of over. And I don't mean that as a bad thing. I mean, as largely it's a good thing. You know, we are no longer Great Gatsby staring at the green light, trying to attain the unattainable. You know, the American dream, while on the one hand it was great for motivating the progress of the 20th century and building factories and getting us all to do lots of stuff, it was false, right? We're there, and now we don't have pension funds. We don't have 401k plans. We don't have a stock market that's going to grow infinitely into the future. We don't have new territories to expand to. We don't have new conquests to make. We're in a different kind of a world now, where we understand that growth is the booby prize. You know, growth is a requirement of, you know, central capital that's lent out at interest and needs to be paid back. Growth is not necessarily a sign of health. You know, new housing starts are good for the economy, the way we currently have it configured, but they're not good for the environment, you know, and we already have more than enough houses. You know, we need new housing starts. The way we get them is by tearing down other houses that we don't let people live in because they don't have jobs, which we can't find for them to do because we already have more than enough stuff. So on the one hand, the idea of education is a way to, I'm going to do this so I can follow on this path, so I can get this job and do that thing and make that, you know, that doesn't really make so much sense anymore, because it's false. It's kind of a lie. And a lot of people who've gone through the whole thing and gone through college and ended up $300,000 in debt and without a job or a way to pay it back or a way to go into bankruptcy even, they understand that full well. So I think what that does, though, is it changes the nature of education towards something that's really frightening for educators, but is, what is it about right now? Am I learning? Am I enriching myself? Am I becoming a smarter, more innovative human being? You know, that's what's going to serve you in the real job market of tomorrow. It's not, you know, by the time the corporation has told the city college what skills it wants from its future workers, you know, you're going to graduate and those skills will have changed anyway. You know, you're going to have a bunch of people coming out of college who know how to use the Excel spreadsheet when the company's moved on to Oracle something or other. It doesn't really work that way. The only way to educate yourself in this world, in a world that's going to be more and more about freelancing, is to actually acquire the skill of skills acquisition, to learn how to think critically about the world and the digital media environments that you're spending all this time in. So it's a much deeper kind of a learning. In some sense, you know, it's more liberal arts, not less.
Douglas, you mentioned student loan debt briefly earlier, and current estimates suggest that American students currently have somewhere between $900 billion and $1 trillion in outstanding student loans. Given that tremendous burden placed on the next generation, what are your thoughts on the cost of college and our process of paying for it through private and federal loans?
It's very tempting for people to say, look, why do college when I could go do whatever, one of these, you know, Coursera kind of things, you know, for free, and I could just get the course and just do it. On one level, it's a healthy challenge, right? To the universities that are costing $50,000, $60,000 a year for what? I mean, I totally get that. I mean, the real reason why university educations are supposed to cost a lot, or they do cost a lot, is that your money is not just supporting what you're learning. It's supposed to be supporting the research. You know, you're coming to a research institution. They're doing tier one research, and they're using some of your money to do that. It's hard to justify, right? Because that's the direction we have to go in, is to really kind of bifurcate or divide the skills acquisition nature of education from the deep nature of education. You know, skills acquisition, if you want to learn code or something, you can learn that on Codecademy for free right now. You know, I'm an advisor there. It's a great program. It's absolutely free, and you can go pretty darn deep into it, you know, as much as any regular person could handle, you know. And if you're going to then become a computer scientist, then you might want to go to, you know, a real school, you know, for computer science and actually, you know, go into that. But we can, in some sense, free up the university from that sort of basic skills creation, you know, turn it into less of a consumer, you know, a consumer zone. Oh, I'm going to get these skills and then go get that job. That's not what that's for. That's trade school, you know, or that's what those Barron's books are for in the Barnes and Noble. You can really self-educate basic skills like that, or apprenticeship, you know, with an electrician or with someone else, you know, or the way they train policemen. You know, that's not a college education. That's something else. And it would free up these institutions for people who want to get that. And it's more at that point, I mean, I'm sorry to say, it's either going to be a luxury or it's going to be something that is publicly paid for. You know, I'm looking at teaching in the university now, and I'm having a hard time as a leftist and an occupier. I'm having a hard time justifying going to some $50,000 liberal arts college and you know, teaching the wealthy or the indebted you know, where I can go to, hopefully Queens College or City College or somewhere. And, you know, the kids are spending they're men and women are spending, you know, $5,000 or $6,000 a year to go to a tier one university. You know, at that point, how can I justify the expense? You know, because the research is being paid for by, you know, or should be by corporations or government anyway. So I just have a hard time. I don't know. I have a hard time asking for that much money from people.
I'm glad you brought up Code Academy. What have you learned so far from working on the project?
Well, I mean, the biggie that I think people aren't getting yet is you know, I'm reading like Tom Friedman and all these folks in the Times, and they're writing about MOOCs. And I guess, you know, Codecademy counts as a MOOC to some extent. But Codecademy only teaches code, right? They're not trying to teach philosophy. You know, to teach like the Socratic method online seems really sad when folks like Aristotle and Socrates were talking about how you have to be in person, you know, conspiring with people, literally breathing with a small group of people in a room in order to get anything. So I feel like the computer is a site-specific education place. It's really good for teaching code. It's a great environment to teach code, right? Better than a seminar room, but it's not a great environment to do the seminar, I think. It's a substitute for it, just as it's not a great environment to do, you know, Sabbath. or a fellowship. You know, I wouldn't want to go to an online AA meeting. I think you got to be in the room with the people. Then a seminar in some ways is more like an AA meeting. It is like a lot of things in some sense. The other big thing I've discovered is that the thing that's being disintermediated is not the student to the teacher. It's not like, you know, they think that what's happening is we're getting the curriculum out of the way, so now students can get right to the teacher directly through all this stuff, through the internet, rather than having to go through the university. And I don't think that's it. I think what's the real possibility here is not for student-to-teacher learning to have a new venue, but to see the birth of kind of genuine peer-to-peer teaching and learning. You know, what Codecademy is much less of a place where people have access to teachers. They have access to one another. You know, the curriculums are written by other members of the community. So you end up with communities of learning because the internet is a peer-to-peer place. It's not the place to do hierarchical learning, which still needs a role. You know, I want to go and sit in a room with Stanley Fish, you know, and find out about, you know, how poetry works or how reception theory works. Or if someone wants to sit with me and really understand the biases of media, that's something that happens in a room. And yes, in a lecture, which should not go out, in a seminar, in a preceptorial. That's what those forms do. And just because we have a new technology through which to disseminate information and through which to forge community doesn't mean it replaces every other form of human contact.
In 2011, you published Program or Be Programmed, 10 Commands for a Digital Age. 2 years later, have you thought of any additional commands or revisions to the previous 10 that you suggested?
The big idea I'd want people to get from that, you know, beyond the individual commands, which are kind of sort of convenient ways of talking about the biases of digital media, I want people to get that they are in command. It's just that digital media, the word digit even, goes back to the fingers. These are digital media. They're media that you can kind of use with your hands. You're not just sitting with your eyes watching something like television or some other pre-digital media. These are media through which you make things. So some of the biases I didn't discuss because I didn't want the book to be all Marxist, but is that this is really biased towards production more than consumption. You know, the iPad maybe is biased towards consumption, the iPhone, that the newer tools with these without keyboards are really, you know, turning them much more into viewing screens, entertainment devices, easy ways to buy things and to stream media. But they're not these great tools of production like computers are. You know, it's exciting to me that there's these machines with keyboards and printers and uploading speeds in everybody's homes. This is a way we can make stuff and trade stuff. So this technology is biased towards transaction, you know, towards real people transacting, creating value, and exchanging that value with one another. And I feel like we're companies now are intentionally repressing that bias of this media because it's so destabilizing to the kinds of companies that really depend on us being consumers and not producers.
I'm interested in your thoughts on the future of human and technological evolution. In Chapter 5, called Apocalypto, you discuss your skepticism of the concept of the singularity. What is your biggest critique of the singularity?
I mean, my biggest critique of the singularity is that it's just not true, right? Some of the best minds of my generation, or I guess they're the generation older, the slightly older cyber theorist type people, the technology theorists, they just seem to have to look at this as a story. They can't understand that technology is just, it's just here. It's just now. This is just what's happening. It doesn't necessarily have to be going somewhere. You know, they're inability to contend with a presentist world, with a world that's actually happening now, has led them to just take kind of the old Christian, you know, apocalyptic overlay and stick it on top of this presentist timeline, right? So they it's going somewhere. Well, where is it going? Well, it depends what technology wants. You know, they're humanizing this as if while they're dehumanizing us, saying, okay, technology is on this inevitable quest towards greater states of complexity. And once it's more complex than we are, then human beings no longer really have a role. We can sort of retreat or recede into the background and let technology and achieve consciousness and continue on without us. You know, and the narrative that they're painting, the story that they're writing to try to understand what's going on, because they'd rather have a bad story than deal with the existential quandary of real life. Their story is that, you know, information has been evolving towards greater states of complexity since the beginning of time, and that human beings are just one stage in information's, you know, inevitable journey towards higher states of complexity than we could even imagine. And to me, that really has the medium and the message reversed. I don't think information even exists without, you know, a human mind to understand it, to process it, to give it meaning. Then it, without us, it's not information anymore. It just is. It's just there. I'm trying to sort of debunk the singularity and to debunk the apocalypse, because, you know, it's become much easier for people to imagine, you know, a zombie apocalypse than it is for them to imagine next year. And that's, you know, that's troubling to me. And it's really because we haven't yet embraced the present. We're finding it difficult to do it without losing our sense of place, without losing our sense of meaning. And there's other ways to find meaning, to find your place, you know, to begin doing pattern recognition, to begin understanding the sort of the never-ending game of life, or life is an infinite game rather than as a game that you have to win, declare victory, and then see who's saved and who's damned, that you can go on rather than worry all the time about where is this going. And that's sort of that's, you know, the real challenge of Present Shock.
What are your thoughts on the future of work? Throughout Present Shock, you wrestle with the challenges of our global economy. What knowledge, skills, and abilities do you think people need to cultivate to be successful?
I mean, on the one hand, if we do this right, people are going to have to work a whole lot less than they did before. You know, I'm really of the belief that we've gotten really good at providing goods and services for pretty much everybody who wants them. You know, the real jobs problem that we're having today is not that we need more people to make more stuff. It's that we need people to have jobs so that we can justify giving the stuff that we already have in abundance, right? There's more than enough houses. There's more than enough food. We're destroying houses in California as I speak. We're burning food every week to keep market prices high. So it's not a matter of that. It's a matter now, I think, of people looking at how they can contribute to really making the world a better place, towards, you know, how do I help, you know, look at the areas where there's real crisis, whether it's sustainable energy, global warming, the alarming rate of kids being born with, you know, autism and spectrum disorders, who are going to need caretakers of one sort or another. So many real challenges that are coming up other than how am I going to increase housing starts or create more mortgages or do all of these kind of fake things, because the fake things are going to become less and less relevant. More and more of those people are going to get laid off as the corporations that are really running on fumes lose the ability to do so. And our ability to participate not just in that big economy, but in the local economy of real goods and services, the value that you're actually able to create for other people in where you live or through the net, is going to become a much more, I hate to use it like the word like this, but a much more marketable skill than the kinds of things that you think that you think of currently as careers.
Douglas, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
For more interviews and information about Douglas Rushkoff's work, please visit educationfutures.com.